Tom, how are you, sir?
Matthew, nice to see you again.
Long time. It's been February. It's a very long time. Yeah. You've been keeping well?
I've been keeping well. We've been very, very busy since we last talked to you, and plugging away. Hopefully, I'll be in your neck of the woods, you know, by the end of the summer. I just had my second Pfizer shot. So hopefully I'll get over to your beautiful area at some point.
Good, good, good. I hope you don't get trapped here this time.
No.
Right. So I'm going to say to people, we've spoken a couple of times before. We'll put the links to those conversations below. Go and see those if you want to understand the business plan, strategy, team, and what these guys are trying to do. Today, we're going to get an update on Iska. But before we do, can you just give us a little update? What's happening in Peru with the, you know, La Victoria project? Obviously, the headlines come out of Peru are, I guess, worrying some people. What's the reality on the ground?
Well, from the standpoint of the recent election, I believe that Pedro Castillo, who's more of on the left wing side of things, I believe he has actually won. I know there was a recount. I'm pretty sure he's moved ahead. I mean, marginally by a percent. However, because of that close margin, the lower house will not have the strength. He will not have the support of the lower house, you know, to move on radical left wing moves such as increased taxes and you know, confiscation issues at all. So I think it'll be business as usual, especially from the, you know, the main operators, some of the bigger, copper, gold operations that we see in Peru. So I from our standpoint, you know, again, the La Victoria project in Peru is not our focus. Obviously, it's Iska, but we are working closely with the community to move forward on an inaugural drill campaign on the sweet spot in our 90 square kilometer land package in Peru called San Marquito. And our partners from Australia that can earn a 25% interest are very motivated to, you know, complete a drill campaign as soon as we get the land rental agreement contract. We're very close to that. So I don't think it's going to change from the external standpoint, from the election. I'm not too concerned at all.
Yeah, I think we're hearing the same sorts of things, that this is a political posturing, and once things have died down, it will be business as usual. Happening a lot in South America at the moment, but I thought it was worth checking in with you. Anyway, we're here to talk about Iska today, your Bolivian project. You've been drilling since we last spoke. You're going to give us a little update. So what have you been up to?
Well, we've been busy. The Leduc drillers, we have three drills now, you know, that contracted through Leduc. We have two surface drills and one underground drill that are active. I mean, we're averaging production rates of close to 100 meters per drill, 300 meters a day. So I think we're close to 14,000 to 15,000 meters to date since we initiated the inaugural drill campaign back in September of 2020. So it's been a fantastic, from the production side, it's been very, very productive. We have Dr. Osvaldo Arce, who's, you know, boots on the ground, who's overseeing everything in Bolivia, and back and forth with Dr. Pearson, who I will introduce to your audience today, who's our senior VP of exploration. He and Osvaldo work very closely together, having known each other for many years. So yeah, I mean, we're very, very pleased. We have a minor issue, nothing to do with us, but it's more external in that the COVID situation is hindering our turnaround times in regard to our assay results at the assay lab, the final lab in Lima, Peru, due to the oxygen argon gas restrictions that are needed actually for assaying, but also the hospitals need them for COVID patients. So that's the only sort of setback temporarily. But other than that, yeah, we're coming in with some pretty interesting long intervals of commercial material in many cases from the last few press releases since I've seen you, Matthew. So, yeah, we're very, very pleased with what's going on.
Right. Okay. And the other thing you've done, actually, before you introduced me to Bill, is you raised some money, $25 million, which is good news. Who came in? What did you see there in terms of the structure of the register now? Has that changed then?
Well, the registry now, I would say is probably 60% institution due to these past two bought deal private placements. This recent one, well, over 2 months ago now, was basically spearheaded again by Haywood Securities, but we brought in also Cantor Fitzgerald and also Cormark. But we did actually pick up a couple of pretty large institutional accounts from actually London, England. There's still a lot of retail. And we're thankful for that are on our register. But yeah, we're starting to get some institutional presence now.
Okay, that's interesting that the UK is kind of stepping into
this
as well.
I'll tell you what I think starting to happen here. This is deemed, we've always sort of looked at this as more of a silver polymetallic multi-metal type deposit, but we're coming in with a lot of tin, especially in our central breccia pipe, which is basically the third breccia pipe that we've discovered. There seems to be quite a bit of tin that we're witnessing. And I think the British community understand the dynamics of the tin market, how tight it is. So there haven't been major tin discoveries in quite some time. And I think this might be something of strong interest to a lot of people these days. So Bill can expound on that somewhat, but so we're getting a good cross-section of institutions now coming into the story.
Okay, interesting. Well, you better introduce me to Bill.
Yeah, so I'd like to, now that we're, basically Eloro's activities, 95% focused in on the Iska, I thought it'd be a good time to introduce Dr. Bill Pearson to your audience. Bill, I've known Bill since the 90s. We used to actually were involved on some sort of emerging plays way back, back in 95, 96 in Colombia and Ecuador. So we've known each other a long, long time, just prior to before the BRIEX fiasco. However, Bill has over 40 years experience in the, he was also the founder of the, or one of the main drivers of the Geoscientist Association of Ontario. Bill was instrumental in the huge discovery, the add-on discovery of the Jacobina deposit when he worked for Desert Sun. And again, a doctorate of geoscience. He's had a lot of experience on Cordilleran and Andean epithermal systems. So, he and I stayed close together. And so I was very pleased to bring him on two or three years ago into Eloro. And so he oversees our operations from Toronto in conjunction and consultation with Dr. Osvaldo Arce, who's on the ground. So I'd like to introduce Bill to your audience and perhaps ask him, some questions on our development.
Hello, Bill. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
How's that for an introduction? It wasn't too bad, was it?
Well, no, it's not too bad.
I've had a lot of practice.
your reputation precedes you, Bill. You didn't need it. You didn't need it. Well, lovely to meet you. And you're going to sort of take us a little romp through Iska. I'm keen to understand what you were tasked with doing. So when you got first introduced to this project, what were you seeing and what are you now seeing in terms of the way that you feel you need to approach it?
Well, it's an interesting question because, this all started because I do have experience in Bolivia. Osvaldo is the expert on metalliferous ore deposits in Bolivia. In fact, to his full credit, he spent the lockdown and doing a second edition of his landmark book, which Tom and I were one of the people who helped sponsor publishing it. And, both of us felt that it was a good time to get into Bolivia. I never doubted the potential there. The politics have changed quite considerably. Luis Arce is doing a good job. In fact, Bolivia seems to me one of the most stable countries in South America right now. He's been very clear he wants foreign investment. We saw companies like New Pacific go in there. You know, Bob Buckins has just moved in and bought the San Bartolome. And of course, Sumitomo's been there for many years, and as has Pan American. So it seemed like an opportune time. So I said originally to Oswald, well, let's see what we can come up with. And he came up with this Iska, and that was in 2019. We did a due diligence program on there, which Oswaldo did. And I remember the first pictures he sent back of the portal of the adit. And my first reaction was, wow, these rocks are hammered. And I think what your audience needs to appreciate is how important systems are when you explore. I'm a system guy. So investors will look at numbers. I look at the system. If the system is there, I can find the resource. And even though what Edwin Villegas, the owner, was doing, you know, he had a, I don't want to really call it an artisanal. It's a higher level than artisanal. But he was mining high-grade lead, zinc, silver veins and being rather frustrated because, you know, they weren't going too far, and he was kind of disappointed on results. And that's where Oswaldo got brought in originally on this. So when I looked at it with Oswaldo, the channel sampling, and we did some innovative work. I do a lot with Western University, and we did, I had them do a synchrotron study. Very, very well. That's a really, really interesting particle accelerator they use down in University of Chicago. And it allows you to do rapid analysis of samples and gives you mineralogy. It's an amazing machine. And my colleagues at Western have a tremendous setup. And when those results came back, it told us, hey, this is one big system with some really high areas. And of course, the target here was always bulk deposit. If you want to find a bulk deposit, you want to have widespread, strong alteration and mineralization. You want to basically have a base level. And then you have the higher grade areas. So that was where we started. And then when we, and the other thing that was remarkable was starting off drilling, the first drilling on this property, never been drilled before from underground. I mean, I've done lots of underground work, drilling in my career, but I've never done it as the first thing. Anyway, and as I'll show you, that happened to be very fortunate that we did start underground, and I'll explain why. So when we started underground, we of course started around the working area. And the third hole we put out to the east, bingo, we hit a breccia pipe. Well, and Oswaldo was seeing every deposit of consequence in Bolivia. He says, wow, I've never seen this anywhere else in Bolivia. So we knew we were onto something, even though this pipe was not that large. It was maybe, 150 by 200 meters. Well, of course, instantly we said, wait a minute, breccia pipes, they don't usually occur by themselves. There's got to be a cluster. And we did bring in a surface rig because we sort of got beyond the extent we could do from the underground. And we did a few more holes. And while we were waiting for results there, Oswaldo and I said, well, we got to get some holes out to the west. And Oswaldo had identified a target from satellite imagery that we thought might be a breccia pipe to the southwest. So we stuck a hole out there, and we ended up with 180 meters of just absolutely beautiful mineralized breccia. It was clear it was a big breccia pipe. And I remember telling Tom, we got to press release this. This is really, really significant. that is the only press release in my entire career on a drill hole that I've put on based on visual criteria only. And of course, subsequently, we put out the assays on this in January 26th. And of course, that was our discovery hole 15. And it was interesting, as soon as we started hitting this breccia pipe, I said to Oswaldo, man, you got to get our geologists out there and figure out what's going on. So they went out there early the next morning and spent all day there, came back just before dark. And all they said was mucha breccia, mucha breccia, mucha breccia. And that's when we put out the map where we thought, hey, Santa Barbara is probably 400 meters in diameter. And there was another one, Central, which was even bigger, 4 by 700. So that's what we started with. And then because of the shape of these breccia pipes, as you can imagine, they're sort of oblate, cylinder-like things. It's not like you're drilling a big structure that has gold mineralization, so you're going along the structure. So what I was able to do was we stuck the drill in the middle and we did radial drilling because there is no preferred orientation in a breccia pipe. And so that's where this whole thing got going. And of course, we started to hit more intersections. We've hit a lot of good holes, and I'll show you in this slide.
Well, let's do that. Muchos, muchos. Let's get into it.
Okay, so here's a geology map here. Basically, what we have at Iska is we have what's called a caldera complex. And you can see the scale here. It's 1.8 by 1.6 kilometers in diameter, very, very extensive. And it's got very, very widespread silver, tin, polymetallic. It's a porphyry epithermal style complex, but as I'll show you, it's much different. Like, forget about what you know about copper porphyries, gold epithermals elsewhere in the Andes. Bolivian style of mineralization is different. And of course, the age of mineralization is similar to our other famous neighbors, but as I'll show you, there's some interesting differences. So you can see this is a plan map here. The initial discovery up to the north, we call Wawakaza. That's a small pipe, but then we found Santa Barbara, which is in yellow, which is, as I'll show you, much bigger than the original 400 meters, and then Central to the south. We also have a big target down in the south we're starting to drill now called Porco, which again is interpreted from geological mapping and satellite analysis. So again, I bring you back to the scale here. It's really, really huge. The other thing, as I'll show you, is the mineralization is just not restricted to the breccia pipes. In fact, there is a huge envelope around these pipes that is several hundred meters or more. In fact, if you look at our discovery hole, hole 15, you can't tell where the dacite ends and the breccia starts from just looking at the assays. Next slide. Now, this is a really, really interesting map. We just released this week. This is a magnetic map of magnetics. It's using a technique called analytical signal. And basically, you can see that I've superimposed the outline of the breccia pipes. And you can see how the and you can see the ring structure of the caldera. And you can see how beautifully those structures are picked up by the magnetic survey. And you can see that the big breccia pipes, Santa Barbara, Central, and our Porca target are all marked by lows. And indeed, it looks like Central and Porco may in fact merge at depth. And you might ask, well, okay, why are they blue? They're blue because the hydrothermal alteration which is very strong, has destroyed all the magnetite. And so consequently, when you go over those areas, the magnetic signature is very, very flat. So this was a very exciting survey result, and it shows that our interpretation of the geology is bang on. And it certainly confirms Porco as a major target. And you can see the sort of pinky areas, like Wawakaza, for example, is sitting in a pink area. And you might ask, well, why is it pink and the other ones are blue? Well, the reason it's pink, as I'll show you, there's a very, very major stage of structural upgrading and remobilization that is really making Santa Barbara and Central, and I think will make Porco, but it's not present. We only have two of the three stages at Wawakaza, so the alteration is there, but nowhere near as intense as where it is on the other three big pipes. You can also see there's a very interesting area in the northwest there that's also blue. Well, we're not sure. That may be an extension of Santa Barbara. That's something we have to explore. So this was a really, really good survey. We are going to start some additional geophysical surveys later this month. We're going to use a technique called induced polarization. And basically, this is a technique where you shoot a current into the ground, you turn it off, and you see how long the current is held by the rocks. So if you have, and also this gives you how resistant the rocks are. And so the big feature we're looking for, which is the key in this deposit, is to track the sulfides. Where we have sulfides, we have mineralization. More sulfides, more mineralization. And the chargeability that you get from IP is just a beautiful technique to track it. So those will be ongoing. But this magnetic map is one of the most beautiful I've ever seen. My geophysicist was ecstatic about this.
But you kind of got me thinking there. When people look at these maps, you automatically go for the red because you think, oh, red is good, blue not good. But you've just explained that's not the case anymore. You have to come up with a new way of coding it.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. You do have to remember, and there's a fairly technical reason behind using this analytical signal. When you're down in the equator, the magnetic field is very flat. So whereas people will be used to looking at a total field map up in Canada, it doesn't work in South America, especially near the equator. So that's why you use the analytical signal. But you're absolutely right. The lows are important. It would be analogous, for example, if you were looking for kimberlite pipes up in the territories or Nunavut. You're looking for circular lows. Same idea. So, you know, this is very, very useful in refining our target definition and also confirming that our geological interpretation was really bang on. You know, our team in the field did a tremendous job mapping these out. So very, very pleased with these results. Next, go to 21. So let's look at a little more detail. This is a plan map showing our two big breccia pipes, Santa Barbara in the yellow, Central in the gray. You can see the green around there. That's dacite. That's part of the dacitic domes that these breccia pipes are going through. And interestingly, Santa Barbara is quite different from Central. Santa Barbara is probably a little higher level feature, and the mineralization in Santa Barbara is silver, lead, zinc, and tin. Whereas in Central, it's much more a silver, tin, plus some gold. It really has very, very little in the way of lead and zinc. And that's because the rock types are different. So in Santa Barbara, they're primarily dacitic fragments. So this breccia pipe has come up through these dacitic domes. Now, Santa Barbara is about 800 meters across or along by 400 to 500 meters across. We've drilled it down to 700 meters. So if you can imagine when the explosion went off that created this thing, it was immense. You would not have wanted to be in southern Bolivia. And that's roughly around 15 million years ago. And that breccia is an absolutely perfect host for mineralization. And I'll explain a little later how we think all this formed. Central is a little different. It's what we call an intrusion breccia. It's come from deeper down, and that's part of the reason why it's more of a has more tin. The other very interesting thing is you see that Santa Barbara adit, and I'll show you a section. That adit is one that Edmund Villegas excavated. And, you know, the results in there for him weren't very good because the mineralization is all in the stockwork. And he actually hit the Santa Barbara breccia pipe at the end of the adit. But none of those things are very good for artisanal miners. But as I'll show you, very, very good for potential miners like ourselves. Go to 22. So then let's look at a long section here. You can see the index map at the bottom. You can see the section line to the from the southeast to the northwest. That's going right along the axis. And you can see on here in the middle our discovery hole, which was 129.6 grams silver equivalent per ton over 257 meters. And it has silver, gold, zinc, lead, copper, tin, quite a remarkable hole. Now, one of the questions people ask me is, well, why wasn't this thing found before? I mean, the Spanish had thousands of people out there prospecting. There's been companies in Bolivia before. Well, the reason is, if you look at the top of the section, you'll see oxide zone, sulfide zone. Well, when you're in the oxide zone, all the metals, especially lead, zinc, and silver, are all leached out. So if you go to the surface there and you sample, you won't get anything. But the fact that we started underground drilling, as you can see, we started in the sulfide zone. So if we had gone into this property and done the conventional, say, 200-300 meter line of holes at 45 degrees, we would have been very disappointed, because we wouldn't have got deep enough. So the fact that we started underground drilling was a huge plus. And of course, we understand that now. And interestingly, the one thing we do get values of up in the oxide is tin, because tin is already an oxide, it's cassiterite, and it doesn't move. The other thing we put out not too long ago is the channel sampling on the Santa Barbara adit. Now, a lot of people don't understand channel sampling. They think, oh, we just went along and, you know, hit a chip of rock here and there. Well, I can tell you it took the team 3 weeks to do, and they channel sampled it continuously. And you can see the tremendous results there, 442 grams silver equivalent per ton over 166 meter with very, very high silver. And we had a section here of remarkable stuff that was over 1,000, over 56 meters with 446 grams silver per ton, 9% lead, 1.16, spectacular. And you can also see that mineralization is in the dacite outside of the mineralization. So what you have here, we have this mineralization, looking at a longitudinal section here, it's up to about 500 meters thick. You can see at the top, 800 meters long. And you'll notice it crosses all the rock types. And I'll explain to you in our little later slide why we think that has happened. And this thing is just growing and growing. We need more drilling to the west, obviously, which we will do after we do our downhole. But again, the thing that I like to emphasize about Iska is the scale of this. This system is huge. Go to 24. So let's just go to, this is another, a really, really nice cross section. You can see on the index map down there, it's going on the northwest side of Central through the eastern part of Santa Barbara. And you see the scale, that's 1 kilometer you're looking at there. And again, this zone is 500 meters plus thick. Now we put out not very long ago our first hole on the central breccia pipe and DCN01. You can see the results down the hole, lots of multiple mineralized intercepts. Very, very nice 196 grams silver equivalent. And that's 150 silver, 0.1 tin, 0.05 gold. Notice no lead zinc. And that also had a very high section in there, over 27 meters. The other hole we released during that, we don't have the assay results yet, but visually it was so remarkable that we decided to put it out, was hole 10. And hole 10 was collared in the center of the Santa Barbara breccia pipe and drilled at minus 60. And we drilled it down to 1,019 meters, our deepest hole we had. We hit this remarkable zone about 500 meters long of quite amazing sulfide mineralization. And I'll show you in the next slide shortly just a few pictures of the core so you can get a feeling for it. So when you look at this target zone, and bear in mind, this is still very, very early days at Iska. We're looking at a target zone here that is a kilometer across, 800 meters long, 500 plus meters that is entirely open. We're drilling, obviously, as Tom mentioned, we have 3 drills going, excellent production. I've worked on a lot of projects over the years, but I have never worked on one. We have not had one blank hole in this system. It's quite remarkable.
So when you talk about scale, Bill, just on the scale side of things, and just answer that question, because that's really interesting. That's really interesting, certainly to me, because we've seen some of the results that come out, and I appreciate there's a lot more coming through. You know, you're sort of almost halfway through a drill program here, and the numbers are great. As a polymetallic, they look great, but the scale of the opportunity is what's going to allow you to compete and, you know, to allow you to stand out. So when you say, oh, the scale here, how do you know that? What have you done?
Well, I know that because I've done enough drilling and I can now, like when we put this section out, we had enough drilling to outline where we thought the mineralized system is. And obviously, yes, there's some variability in it. There's sections that are higher grade. There's sections that are lower grade, but there's no sections that have no grade. It is basically continuously mineralized through that whole section. And when you're dealing with this kind of mineralized section zone, the important thing is to realize that as you get more holes in, you will get better definition of the higher grade areas. The more higher grade areas, you're going to lift the overall grade, because you know that whenever you put a hole in this thing, you're probably going to get at a minimum, 50, 60 gram silver equivalent. And then the higher grade areas kick you well over 100. And, you know, one of the things we've always talked about on this is, you know, $100 US per ton rock. Well, you're very, very nicely in that range, particularly with obviously the tin price being up, silver being up. It's a powerful combination. So, you know, this is not a uniform type of deposit. In fact, most deposits aren't. But what really makes any bulk deposit is to have a very good, solid background mineralization. And then within it, you have higher grade zones. And when you take the whole package, bingo, you're in business. That's exactly what I see here. Obviously, we've got to do some more fill-in drilling to get to a resource here. But the picture evolving is very, very exciting. And if you sit there and you do the math, you very easily get to, you know, very, very large potential tonnage. Still early, needs some more drilling. But all the holes we have done continue to add and refine the picture and continue to expand this target.
Absolutely. And at what point do you start bringing the network in and trying to understand, you know, how you approach this from that perspective?
You mean from
the metallurgical work? Yeah, exactly.
Well, you know, as we said a number of times, our objective here is to get to an NI 43-101 resource by late fall. We will certainly, I think, be able to do that on Santa Barbara as long as we get our assays from the lab and immediate environs. We won't cover everything by then. But once you get, and it will be likely mainly an inferred resource because our drilling is wide space. At that point, once you have an NI 43-101 resource, even inferred, you can go ahead and look at doing preliminary economic evaluation. And we're already doing some important, you know, preliminary metallurgical tests, which will be a big item here. So, you know, that is something that I would certainly see moving forward on in, say, early 2022. And over the years, I've worked on an awful lot of economic studies from everything from preliminary economic evaluations through to feasibility studies. I've done mine openings like Desert Sun at Jacobina. So one of the things that I make sure is we do the upfront work from the geological end that you need to move this project forward in the downstream end. So I think you'll certainly see that, you know, move forward. But at the same time, we're going to be continuing to drill and expand this resource. If we can confirm Porco, then you can see that this will be a true giant.
Right.
I just want to quickly explain to your listeners. Can you go to the model slide there, Jimena? Just for one second here. This is a model from Oswaldo Arce's book here. This is a typical porphyry epithermal complex, and he's put the positions of the different major deposits in southern Bolivia. Cerro Rico de Potosí, of course, is a world famous biggest silver deposit, produced some 2.5 billion ounces over the years. You can see the scale on the left, 1 kilometer. Well, you can see that Iska is sitting in this same nice sweet spot here. And in fact, ultimately, I think we will find mineralization at different levels as we get more drilling into the system. Just go to the next slide. So this is a model that Oswaldo put together. Now, I think it's really important that your readers realize, and I certainly learned this, the geology of southern Bolivia is totally different than the rest of the Andes. We have the famous Bolivian tin belt, which really has no parallel in the rest of the Andes. And because of that, the style of deposit is quite different from what people are used to. So this was why I got Oswaldo to put together these sort of cartoons. So we're really looking at three stages of mineralization. And the first stage is tin porphyry. And tin is a high temperature metal, forms deep in the crust. So that's the first take. And all through this, a big tin porphyry has been driving this process. The second stage are the dacitic domes. And these domes are cut by these huge breccia pipes. And again, imagine the immense power. And during that stage, you get extensive epithermal silver, lead, zinc, tin mineralization. And the third stage that really, really makes Iska is this extensive structural remobilization upgrading. The Andes is a very, very active tectonic regime. And so what's happening is you're getting rebrecciation of the brecciation, you're getting structures out into all the rocks, and you're moving and concentrating these metals, silver, lead, zinc, and tin. And that's why you are seeing mineralization across all the rock types. It's you've moved metals out of their primary deposition site, and you move them into much broader. And then to get to the present day picture, you know, Santa Barbara is probably more or less where it is. Obviously, there was some stuff eroded. Central, that came from much deeper, and it's been uplifted, and the whole thing has been had this remobilization event. Somewhere down below, there is a big tin porphyry. The other thing to note about these breccia pipes is this really seems to be unique to Iska. You might ask, well, why are they in Iska and not elsewhere? Well, they probably were elsewhere, but Iska, they are preserved. And it's because you see that brownish rock, that's quartz sandstone, and in those breccia pipes, there's silicification, all of which are erosionally resistant. So Iska is really a unique setting. The other thing to realize is from the valley to the peak at Iska is 1 kilometer. So we have this remarkably entire preserved volcanic edifice that's full of these remarkably mineralized pipes and intrusion breccias. And that's really what makes Iska very unique. And as we progress with more drilling and the geophysical data will help us out immensely, I think we're gonna continue to grow and refine the overall picture here, but this thing just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And when you consider we only started drilling in September, we're sitting here in June, the pace we're going at is incredible. Have a top team down in Bolivia, but it's the size of the system. Everywhere we go, we hit mineralization and we keep pushing the limits out. And, you know, the number one requirement when you're exploring, understand your system early, and then you can plan and optimize your drill program. And that's precisely what we're doing. So the next 3 to 6 months, I think, are going to be very, very exciting. I'm very confident we'll get to a significant resource by late fall, as long as the labs get us the analysis. And that will be still be a start. It won't be the finish of the process. There's an awful lot more areas we need to test in this, you know, quite amazing complex.
Brilliant. Look, Bill, thanks for humoring me and talking me through it. I wanted to hear it from the horse's mouth, as it were. take that the right way, to try and understand how you're approaching it. And I do appreciate you getting into the detail with me. Tom, that wasn't too bad, was it?
No, it was good. There was one thing I'd like to add, though. You know, I've heard sort of rumors a little bit here and there about that this system is inundated with arsenic, and it could be really problematic, when you mine, trying to separate. I'd like, maybe we could address those initial fears, if Bill would want to, brush over that at this stage.
Well, it's interesting because, yeah, this kind of cropped up because there was a mention of it in Charlie Mahawi's report. And those samples came from a high-grade gold bismuth zone. And when you see higher arsenic here, it pops up periodically. And it's almost invariably associated with high gold. So where did the gold come from? Because Iska is a high sulfidation system. High sulfidation systems are low in arsenic. And that's what we see in the vast bulk of samples. But it does kick up locally where you hit high gold. So where did this gold come from? Well, there's a stage of mineralization called orogenic gold, which is in the basement sandstones. So there was some type of orogenic gold deposit, probably not that big, but it was there when the Iska caldera complex formed. And so that mineralization has got caught up into the overall system, especially when things have been structurally upgraded and moved around. So it really is a local phenomenon. We, of course, track it. But if you look at the bulk of data on arsenic, and we analyze for that for all our samples, most of it is very low. But of course, what happens is people glom on a few samples and they think, oh my God, that's the whole distribution. Well, it's not. It's very localized.
Right. We've seen these sorts of stories come up before, and companies have different approaches to it. I mean, I know you're not dismissing it, and you're gonna have to do some work to try and understand it better, because at the end of the day, that's gonna affect your economics if you can't come up with a solution. So how do you go through that process of trying to understand it between now and, say a 43-101 or a PEA?
Well, I think as we have, when we do the mineral resource estimate, as you can imagine, this is a fairly complicated one to estimate, because we're going to have to do a model for silver, do a model for lead, zinc, a model for tin, and we will do a model for any deleterious elements as well. So that, because, the fact is, yes, it is there in certain areas. It's not that extensive. You still need to know where they are, and you have to deal with it. The other thing is you need to do some mineralogy to figure out exactly where that arsenic is held too. For example, if you have arsenical pyrite, may not be an issue. We know there's some sections with arsenopyrite. That'll be part of the overall resource estimation procedure. And maybe there will be a few sections that will not be that favorable, or they'll need a bit of a different process. This is a really, really unusual one because, you can go along our drill hole assays and suddenly you'll see cadmium zoom up or bismuth zoom up, or you'll have a high lead zinc silver come out of nowhere, or like hole six, we had 73 meters of 0.43 tin. And you go, wow. So that's one of the reasons why we've had Micon involved in this whole process early on. They're doing some preliminary analysis. We're getting to a point now where we can start to actually do some initial analysis to get some feeling. But one of the things that your readers need to appreciate is that this is not like a big structure where you've got a clear direction you're dealing with. You're, you're dealing largely what we refer to as an isotropic medium. In other words, there's no real directional bias here. So it makes it tricky. Ultimately, you know, the overall cutoff grade will be determined by some sort of Bach NSR, but the actual distribution of the metals, you know, that'll have to be looked at on an individual basis. And you will also have, like, if you're mining central, you're going to get tin, silver and tin with some gold. Interestingly, when we go deeper, we get more gold. But that's not the same gold as that high-grade gold that is with the arsenic. So, but anyway, we're aware of that. We certainly will track it, and it'll get considered in the resource. But people need to understand that that's something that's inherited. It's not part of the big mineralizing system. The values are quite, really quite low.
Tom, why did you bring it up? Why did you mention it?
We've just heard, you know, just in the media and such, some people are talking about that this is inundated with arsenic. And, you know, I mean, I just want to, because I just think it's something that really should be addressed, and that we are addressing it via the, you know, the testing with through Micon, and that from our standpoint, you know, it should be explained. That's all.
But what do you think people are worried about?
Oh, just that it'll create so much cost and separating the arsenic that it, you know, it could prove to be a non-economic situation, which is, you know, we want to make it very, very clear that that just is not the case, because as Bill explained, the arsenic, if there is higher levels in certain instances, it's due to, you know, some of the, you know, concentrations of gold that we might see here and there. But even if there was, I mean, they have such things as autoclaves, which are expensive, but there are different techniques to deal with it. And it's probably 5% of the overall system. So I just want to clear that, very clear that it is not something that the investor should be concerned about. That's right. Why I'm bringing it up.
Perfect. And so, I mean, but given there is a narrative going on out there, and whether it's 5% or 50%, you're going to have to spend some time and effort dealing with that. Does that change the way you come at this project? Because of market perception is something you need to manage as well as what you're doing in the field, isn't it?
Well, I think the best way to manage these things is, you know, Micon is doing an updated NI 43-101 report. One of the issues that we will address, have them address in that report. The only way to look at it is put the data in. You know, people read one press release or read one page in a report and they go all nuts. The only way to counter that is to put the data on the table and say, if I showed you a graph of arsenic in the deposit, you see a classic ski jump where the vast majority of the values are pretty low. And that's the reality. And obviously that's the advantage of having an independent consultant. You know, you can choose to believe or not believe me, but, you know, certainly, as we've discussed with Micon, there's no doubt there is some, yes, we have to deal with it, but it's not like the whole deposit is full of it. That's a distinction. So you will see that 43-101 in the near future. And one of the other reasons I want to get that done is that paves the way for the resource estimate, because the resource estimate is just adding one chapter to the report that's already written. So, I mean, I've done loads of these reports myself, and I know how to do them very, very efficiently. So that's all in the process. You know, we have preliminary met tests going. We did some initial work with the laboratory in University of Rural. You know, these guys have spent their life doing polymetallics, and you know, we're getting some, it's early obviously, but certainly getting some encouraging results. And we'll expand that, you know, sort of testing. So by the time we get to that resource report, you'll obviously see a statement on resource, but we obviously have to bring in potential recovery into the mix. So we've got that. And once we get to that, then, you know, the mining, you can start looking at, okay, I know that zone's there. How do I sort of mine it? But, you know, as I always say to people, you know, there's a tendency to focus on, hey, we got to do all the engineering studies and get to a pre-feas or a feasibility. The reality is that what drives a PEA, a pre-feas or a feasibility study is not, in fact, the engineering. It's the status of your resource.
Yeah.
You can do all the engineering you want, but if your resource isn't there, you're not going to go anywhere. And I'll guarantee you that won't happen on my watch, because I've done this many, many times
before. So, Matthew, I just wanted to make a quick point. You know, when Bill mentioned, you know, a tin intersection of 0.43% over 70 meters, just so that your audience understands, you know, when we look at it per ton of rock, that value, like for instance, 0.43, I mean, basically it's very simple math. You just double it into pounds. So it's like 0.43 is 8.6 pounds of tin per ton of rock, 8.6 times 15 US a pound. That gives you a valuation of over $100 rock per ton. So, you know, this is why I'm really sort of fired up also on the tin component.
Well, yeah, it's topical at the moment. Guys, I'm just sort of conscious of time. And like I say, Bill, like thank you for humoring me and getting into the weeds with us today. Tom, sure, we will see you again soon, especially when some of these assay results start coming through. And it'd be great to sort of see how we are going to approach the rest of this year, or you are going to approach the rest of this year. It's been a good one so far. Keep it up, guys.
Thank you very much, Matthew.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Matthew.